हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेल्कम बैक। मैं सर पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो एज यू नो, टुडे यू हैव द 12th of May 2021। ऑलराइट, एंड दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेसिकली बेस्ड ऑन द करंट अफेयर्स ऑन द डे टू डे बेसिस, एंड वी आर बेसिकली रेफरिंग द टू नेशनल न्यूज़पेपर्स, द हिंदू एंड इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। Okay, you can also refer any of these newspapers. Both of are equally good, and these lectures would be definitely supplementing your preparation, right, for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC. All right, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, where you will get a day-to-day current affairs based these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is related to the initial public offering, right? So some initial public offering for that purpose, the SEBI, which is the Security and Exchange Board of India, right, which is a market regulator, right? So the Security and Exchange Board of India have basically proposed certain changes in basically in the initial public offering. So what has changes the Security and Exchange Board of India have been proposing is that the SEBI basically proposing to rationalize the definition of a promoter group, right? I'll let you know what is promoter group, right? And in place of this promoter group, the SEBI basically would like to involve the concept called the person in control, right? So it want to rationalize the definition of the promoter group, and instead moving that concept to of the person in the control, right? Specifically in an IPO, right? As well as the SEBI is also pitches for the minimum lock-in period for the promoters for that purpose. Okay. Now, as I told you that SEBI is basically suggesting certain rationalization in the promoters group, right? In the current definition, that basically focusing on certain group of the people or the individuals, right? Which often, you know, results in some sort of a, some sort of issues with regarding to those promoters groups. So which are the main cause of concern as per the SEBI is informing. So what is SEBI is all about? The SEBI is basically the regulatory body for the purpose of the securities and commodity market in India. As you already probably know, right? The SEBI comes under the Ministry of Finance under Government of India, and it has given the statutory provision under SEBI Act 1992. So SEBI is basically a regulatory body. The main task of the SEBI is to regulate the securities and the commodity market in India. Now, what is the issue is that there is some issue related to those, the promoters group, right? So what is, first of all, what is this promoter is all about? Why this promoter is causing some issue related to IPO? So promoter is basically, you can see the promoter is an idea, right? Or promoter basically can be a person, right? Can be a firm or can be associations of the person or can be a company. So promoter can be of anything, right? So promoter basically, whoever the promoter is there, the promoter basically conceives the idea. It has some idea, right? What for? What for? The setting up of a particular business in a given place, right? And the promoter would like to perform certain, you know, various formalities, right, which are required for the purpose of starting a company, right? So that promoter may be an individual, a group, or a firm or association, or a group of persons, or even a company, right? Now, what is this promoter group? The promoter group is something you can understand is that it is basically an immediate relative of a promoter, right? Like when you say the promoter group, that means it may be a spouse of a person, it may be a parent, it may be a brother, it may be a sister, or it may be a child of a person, right, which is basically promoting a business. Right now, the person who is even holding the shareholding, right, is also considered for the purpose of this promoters group, right? So that is basically some problem that is basically occurring with those the promoters group. Now what is happening is that a consultation paper is basically proposed by SEBI, right? In that consultation paper, what is the problem is the SEBI is facing is that, right, in the 3-year transition period, right, that is basically moving, right, that the SEBI is basically pitching for, you know, moving over from this promoter to basically person in the control, right? This shift is necessary as per the SEBI, Right. It is necessary because nowadays the investors landscape is basically changing in India, as you know, right? Where you will be probably seeing in the newspapers also that the concentration of the ownership and controlling right, and talking in terms of the company, right? The ownership rights and controlling rights do not vest completely in the hands of a promoters or promoter group, right? Because of some sort of emergence of the new stakeholders. These stakeholders may be a private entity or the private equity or even institutional investors, right? So what happens is the investor basically focus on the quality of a board and the management has increased. Thereby, what is happening is that the relevance of the concept of the promoter is basically, reducing nowadays, right? And that is basically the cause of the concern for the purpose of this pitching from the promoter to basically the person in the control. Now, this change in the nature of the ownership, what happens could lead to the situations where the person with no controlling rights, right? The person with no controlling rights as well as having some sort of a minority stakeholding, what will happen? They continue to be classified as a promoter, but really they don't have the much stake with them. They don't have the controlling rights of a company, right? So by the virtue of being called a promoter, such persons may have influence over, over the entities disproportionately to their economic interest or disproportionately to their shareholding, right? And which may not be in the interest of all the stakeholders. You are getting my point. So because of the incorporation of the new stakeholders like private equity or institutional investors, these promoters group basically have disproportionate share in terms of their influence over other economic interest of other stakeholders. And that is why this person in the control have used instead of using this promoters group as the SEBI is also SEBI also pitching for that purpose. Okay. So I hope it is clear what is promoter, what is promoters group, and what is the issue is all about. Okay. Now the regulator has also proposed to do away the current definition of the promoter group. As I told you that it wanted to delete it completely and it wanted to rationalize the disclosure burden also, right? Where some sort of a post-listing disclosure requirement would also be fulfilled, right? As the SEBI is basically citing the investors landscape that is basically changing nowadays in the current scenario, specifically in India. So to revisit the concept called the promoter to the concept called to the person in the control who basically have the disproportionate share in terms of their, the influence over such entity, right? So what is happening that this disproportionate share may not be, in the interest of all stakeholders. And so that the promoter should be deleted or rationalized to the concept called the person in the control. And the SEBI is also pitching for, the shift over to the smooth and the progressive manner without causing any disruption in the basically in the business setup all around those definitions. Okay. And with regard to the lock-in periods also in respect to the initial public offering, right, what is happening is that SEBI is also proposing that there should be, right, the lock-in for 1 year from the date of allotment of this initial public offering, right, instead of the using for, the longer time, right? This lock-in period should be there for at least 1 year, right? So this lock-in for 1 year from the date of allotment is also proposed by the SEBI, and it will basically, it is basically to fulfill that objective also. And SEBI is also sought for the comments from the public on this proposal, and the SEBI has already opened the window for the public comments over it, and it will be open till June 10. So the public can basically put their views over such issues that SEBI is basically pitching for that. Okay. And regarding the initial public offering, you know about all of them. Okay. But let us again say briefly about the initial public offering also. See, initial public offering is basically a process, right? It is a process of offering the shares of any private corporation to the public. For example, any private corporation, be it a Reliance or Adani, Ambani, whatever it may be, any private corporation may be involved in, offering those shares to the public in a new stock issuance, right? So what happens is this public share issuance allows the companies to raise, some sort of a capital from the public investor. That is what the share is giving. The share will be purchased by the public and the public will invest it in terms of their money. So that basically raises the capital from the public investor in turn. Okay. the transition from the public to the transition from this private to the public company can be important time, right? Specifically for the private investors, right? Definitely for realizing the gains from their investment, as you know, it involved typically the sharing the premiums for the current private investors. So what happens is it also allows the private investor to participate in the offering also in that process. So that process is called basically your initial public offering. Okay. Next, K.R. Gauri Amma. So K.R. Gauri Amma was basically 102 years old. She was basically a communist leader. She was basically a veteran communist leader. And she was also a leader of the Janadhipatya Sanskana Samiti, which is also known as JSS. And she recently passes away in Thiruvananthapuram. So she basically belongs to the Izwa community, and she is basically associated with the communist, right? And she is basically a very veteran communist leader, and she has basically recently been passed away. R. Gauri Amma, who was also a politician, who has held the several portfolios under the state government as well as the central government also, right? The Gauri Amma basically was an Indian politician, and she was also the first revenue minister in the Kerala state. And she has the ideology associated with the Marxist revolutionary. She was also an advocate, author, and a diplomat for that purpose. So she was a leader of the Janadhipatya Samskarna Samiti. What is the Janadhipatya Samskarna Samiti? It is basically a political party. Okay. Which, if you say in basically in the English term for that is Association for the Defense, for Association for the Defense of Democracy. This is the English term for this party, that is called JSS. So she was a leader of this party called JSS, and this JSS was basically born in Kerala out of CPIM, on Communist Party of India Marxist. So this is the parent party, right? And out of this party, when K.M. Gauri Amma was basically expelled from the Communist Party of India Marxist in 1994, when she was expelled from this party, she basically formed this party, which is known as Janadhipatya Samrakshana Samiti, or Association for the Defense of the Democracy. Okay, regarding Gauri Amma, the Gauri Amma was one of the founding leaders of the communist movement in Kerala. Okay, as I told you that she also headed the Janadhipatya Samskarna Samiti, or JSS, which is a political outfit or political party which is based out of the CPIM, or which is basically comes out of the CPIM when the K. Gauri Amma was basically expelled from the CPIM. And she was the first female law student, as she was the lawyer also, which basically belongs to the Izwa community. The Izwa community predominantly found in Kerala. Okay. And she was the first female minister in terms of the communist led ministries, right? For example, she was already hold the portfolio as a ministers in the several portfolios, like in Kerala in 1957, 1967, 1980, 1987. And she was also a minister in the Congress-led cabinet from 2001 to 2006. Okay. Now, regarding this Izwa community, as the Izwa community basically, it is a major community found in Kerala. It constitutes around 25% of the Kerala population, right? And it is sometimes also known as Tiyar or Tiyar community, right? They are also known as in the Kerala as a Chovan or Cholan, or they are also known as sometimes the Chekwar or the Chekons, okay, all are similar. They roughly constitute around 22 to 25% of the population of Kerala, okay. And the Izwas are basically classified as the other backward classes, or if there comes in the OBCs. Their main work is to do some sort of agricultural laborers or small cultivators or even toddy tappers, right, or small the business persons also, right. And they sometimes also profess Ayurveda, and also they also involve in weaving profession in the Kerala also. She was also a minister in the first democratically elected communist government, which came in Kerala in 1957 by under the leadership of EMS Nambooripad, right? And under EMS Nambooripad cabinet also in 1957, she had the portfolio of the revenue minister, and the Gauriamma was also instrumental in drafting, right, the Kerala Agrarian Relations Bill, which is also, you know, the most important bill with respect to the land reforms which were initiated in the Kerala under the leadership of K. Gauriamma, right? And she was also the longest serving woman legislator in the Kerala, in the Kerala Legislative Assembly, and she was also the oldest woman member in the assembly, and as well as the oldest woman minister. And she has also published an autobiography called The Atmakatha, right? This Atmakatha, or an autobiography which was published by K. Gauriamma, has won the Kerala Sahitya Academy Award in 2011 also. Okay. So she was K. Gauriamma. She was 102 years old and she recently died because of COVID-19 complications. All right. Next. The Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency Limited, that is called IREDA. It is basically a mini Ratna company under Government of India. Okay. Recently, the Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency Limited have been won, right, the Green Urja Award. Right. This is the award which was given this year by Indian Chamber of the Commerce. The IREDA has won this Green Urja Award for being a leading public institution in terms of financing this, you know, the renewable energy in India, right? And it has been awarded to basically, you know, to recognize the substantial, you know, the effort which have been put by IREDA in terms of providing the financial requirement for the purpose of renewable energy in our country. Okay, so the IREDA, or Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency Limited, is basically a mini Ratna company which comes under the category 1 under Government of India's categorization, and it is under administrative control of the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. Okay, and it is basically a public limited company which is established as a non-banking financial institution in 1987 for the purpose of providing this financing for the renewable energy in our country. Okay, and regarding the Indian Chamber of the Commerce, right? The Indian Chamber of the Commerce, if you want to understand a bit more about this entity, so you can also understand the Indian Chamber of Commerce is basically the oldest national chamber of commerce, which is headquartered in Kolkata, right? And it is the most proactive and forward looking chambers in our country today. And you could also understand that it is also diverse also in terms of its membership. For example, its membership involves some of the most prominent and major industrial groups in India also. And it is also popularly known as the premier body of business and the industry, specifically in the eastern and northeastern India. Okay. And as you know that it is set up by a group of pioneering industrialists like the G.D. Birla, who had at that point of the time in 1925 was basically a pioneering industrialist. And the Indian Chamber of Commerce basically is closely associated with Indian freedom movement also, right, in and around 1920s, 1930s, right? And it was also the first organized voice of the indigenous Indian industry at that point of the time, right, when our industry was at the nascent stage. And several distinguished leaders were basically associated with it, right? For example, B.M. Birla, right, Ardeshwar Dalal, right, you know, Goenka, S.P. Jain, Lala Karamchand Thapar, right, all were basically the leading industrialists that were basically associated with the Indian Chamber of Commerce at that point of the time. Okay, so IREDA has this year won the Green Urja Award for the purpose of providing the financing for this renewable energy. So IREDA is notified as a public financial institution which has registered as under Section 4A of the Companies Act 1956. It has been also registered as a non-banking financial company with the Reserve Bank of India, right? The motto of the IREDA is basically to provide the energy forever. And the IREDA is the only dedicated institution for the purpose of providing this financial requirement, right, for energy efficiency projects, for renewable energy projects, right? And since its inception, it has been played a very, very vital and a catalytical role in developing the market for the purpose of this renewable energy as well as the energy efficiency project. And and regarding its contribution, it has been over the years, it has been sanctions, the loans loans of worth of crores of the rupees. For example, it has been sanctioning the loans which is aggregating of around 96,000 crore rupees, and it has already been disbursed around 63,000 crore rupees, right? And the IREDA is also instrumental in providing or supporting, you know, or you know, aggregating or increasing the capacity of the renewable energy in terms of 17,586 megawatt of energy. This is the most important contribution in terms of the renewable energy, you know, the capacity boosting in terms of India, right? When we are transitioning from basically your you know, from your non-renewable energy towards your renewable energy form of energy. Okay, fine. Next, Jal Jeevan Mission. So as you know, the Jal Jeevan Mission is basically a program under Government of India. It basically aspires to provide the tap water connectivity in every rural household by 2024, right? So the Pondicherry, which is a union territory, have become, you know, the fourth, you know, among the union territory and the states, right, which ensure that every rural home gets the household tap connection. Now that means, apart from the Goa, Telangana and Andaman Nicobar Island, the Pondicherry, which have become recently the fourth state, right, or fourth union territory, right, which have achieved the assured tap water supply to every rural household, right, under Government of India's flagship program Jal Jeevan Mission, right. So other three states and union territory, for example, Goa is a full-fledged state, have achieved this. Every rural home has the tap water supply. Apart from the Goa, the Telangana, which has recently been emerged from the Andhra Pradesh in 2014, have also achieved this. Every rural household get the, you know, tap water connection. Apart from that, the Andaman Nicobar Island, which is also, you know, union territory, have also been achieved this objective. And now the Pondicherry, which is the fourth such state, right, fourth such union territory, which have recently been achieved this objective. So Jal Jeevan Mission is basically flagship program of the Government of India, which aim to provide the tapped water connection to every rural household in the country by 2024. So these four states and the union territory, which are the Goa, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Telangana and Pondicherry, have achieved this objective much before 2024. So under Jal Jeevan Mission in 2021-22, for that purpose, an additional 50,000 crore rupees have been budgetly allocated for the purpose of Jal Jeevan Mission, right? And there is also around 26,940 crore rupees have been assured the fund, which is available under the 15th Finance Commission, which have recommended to provide this 26,940 crore directly, the funds which is tied to this rural local bodies. RLB means the rural local bodies or the Panchayati Raj institutions. Panchayati Raj institutions, right? Definitely, you must understand this tapped water supply, specifically in the rural areas, you cannot achieve without the involvement of these rural local bodies or the Panchayati Raj institutions, right? So these institutions are vital for the purpose of providing this tapped water supply. And the Government of India is also, you know, having association with those rural local bodies in order to ensure that every rural household will get the tapped water supply, specifically for the purpose of water sanitation, right? And in that, right, the state government will also use the matching contribution share, right? Because this is what is something as per the Jal Jeevan Mission, the funding requirement will be. Okay, so here you can understand about the Pondicherry. So the Pondicherry is basically, it's a union territory, first of all. And it is formed out of four former territories, which were the French territories. So this Pondicherry was basically a French territory. This Pondicherry was basically consisting of the earlier four such territories. That is Pondicherry. The second is Karaikal, right? And third is Mahé. The fourth is basically your Yanam. These are basically the four states, districts. And the Pondicherry is basically the largest district. So this name of the union territory is basically named after this largest district, which is known as Pondicherry. So Pondicherry is basically union territory consisting of the Pondicherry, Karaikal, Mahé and Yanam. All right. Next, then National Technology Day. So you must understand, when our country in 1998 right, you know, conducted this nuclear test in the Pokhran in Rajasthan. Okay, now to give this impetus or to observe the contribution which was contributed by the Indian scientists and engineers for the purpose of the development of this, the nuclear test, right? The Prime Minister, late Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee has coined this term to recognize and to celebrate the contributions which are made by the engineers and Indian scientists for the purpose of the development of our country. So the government of India has decided to celebrate May 11th, right? The May 11th, 1998 was the date when Pokhran nuclear test was conducted, right? So the government of India has decided to celebrate this May 11th as the National Technology Day, right? To celebrate, you know, the achievements of the engineers and the scientists in the field of technology and the science. You must understand that the Atal Bihari Vajpayee government, or the Atal Bihari Vajpayee who coined this term basically to celebrate or to commemorate the contribution which was made by the engineers and the scientists for that purpose, right? And this gave, you know, some sort of his new strength and the presence across the globe, right, in terms of India's standing as a nuclear capable state. Okay, next, the Orisys REx mission, which have sent to the asteroid Bennu. Now, first of all, let me give a brief introduction about the Osiris Rex mission, right, which have recently been sent to the asteroid Bennu, right, for some investigation purpose. So let us give a brief introduction about that one. So this Orisys Rex mission is basically, it is a basically spacecraft which have recently been sent to the near earth asteroid which is known as Bennu, right? So the Bennu is basically an asteroid which is there, or which is located in the near earth orbit, right? And the main purpose of this Osiris Rex mission is to bring the small samples back to earth for the purpose of the study from this asteroid Bennu. This Osiris Rex spacecraft was launched, right, from Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, USA, right, in 2016, in September 2016, and this spacecraft reached the Bennu in 2018. So it took around, 1.5 years to reach over there in the Bennu, and it will basically stated to return to back to Earth in 2023. So it was sent to the asteroid Bennu in September, 2016. It reached to the Bennu in 2018, and it is supposed to return to Earth back in 2023 after collecting some sort of a material from this asteroid Bennu. Okay, this is what is something that you must understand. Right now, the Bennu, is basically an asteroid which is located at around 200 million miles away from the Earth. It is basically located in the low Earth orbit, right? It is basically a low Earth orbit. Okay, fine. So Bennu is basically named after an Egyptian deity, and it has been discovered, or this asteroid have been discovered by a research team, which basically also known as the Lincoln Near Earth Asteroid Research Team, which is funded by the NASA in 1999. And Bennu is basically a B-type asteroid, right? The B-type asteroid, which is basically having, or the scientists claim that it is having the significant amount of carbon and various other minerals also. Now let us understand what is this asteroid is all about in order to appreciate that one, right? So asteroids are basically, you probably would have read the 11th standard NCERT book, geography, right? So asteroids are basically the small rocky objects, right, which generally orbits around the sun. So the asteroids, although orbit around the sun, just like a planets, they are much smaller than the planets, much smaller than the planets. So asteroids, you can understand, they are small, they are rocky objects, they orbit around the sun, right? And but they are much smaller than the planets. There are a lot of asteroids in our solar system, right? But most of them live in the main asteroid belt. In the main asteroid belt, this asteroid belt is located, is basically between your Mars and the Jupiter. So you have the region between the Mars and the Jupiter where you have the main asteroid belt. Right, so you must understand these asteroids are basically hang out in other places also, right? For example, they are found in almost all orbital paths of the planets, right? So you can understand that the asteroids and the planets follow the similar path around the sun, and the few other planets also have the asteroids also, Now you must understand how come these asteroids are formed. That thing is also coming your mind that. But you must understand for that our solar system was basically originated around 4.6 billion years before, or 4.6 billion years ago. That is basically, you know, the age of our solar system, right? And now what happens? These asteroids are basically the leftover portion of, you know, the formation of our solar system. Now what happens is around 4.6 billion years ago, as per some of the geographers, they believe that the big cloud of the gas and the dust at that point of the time was basically collapsed. And when this collapse happens, right, most of the material fell into the center of the cloud and they basically form sun. So this collapsing of the cloud of the gas and the dust, ultimately, you know, the material falls at the center, and this center ultimately converted into the sun. And some of this condensing dust in the cloud also become the planets ultimately over the period of the time. And the objects in the asteroids, you know, belt, they had never given the chance, or they have never had the chance to either incorporate it in the planets or the sun. So they remain left over from such explosion or from such, the collapse. And then what happens is these leftovers portions were basically hanging over the period of the time, and that is also revolving around the sun, just like in normal planets. Okay. Now let us understand what is the significance of the Bennu. So Bennu is basically considered as an ancient asteroid, right? As I told you that it has lot of similarities with how, you know, our solar system had been formed 4.6 billion years ago. So it has the similarity, lot of composition in terms of, you know, the billions years of the age. So it has got the similar, you know, composition that is below the surface of the Bennu, that is in terms of the chemicals and the rocks, that the birth of our solar system is also originated from that. The scientists and researchers are basically interested in studying this asteroid, that it might give some clue, right, to the scientists regarding the origin of our solar system, regarding the origin of sun, earth and other planets also, right? So you can understand why asteroid Bennu we have chosen for the purpose of our study. So first of all, the chosen asteroid Bennu is basically proximity to our Earth. So that is, the scientists claim that every 6 years the orbit in which the Bennu is basically, you know, revolving, that brings to the Earth every 6 years, that is less than 450,000 kilometers away, and that is very near. And this orbit allows the spacecraft to go there and to bring back also safely with some raw material. And regarding its size is comparatively bigger than other asteroids. For example, asteroids which are less than, you know, 200 meters wide in terms of their width. So you can think that if the width is less, what happens is they would spin very, very quickly. So it will be very difficult for the spacecraft to pick some material from the asteroid. But this size of the asteroid of the Bennu is around 490 meters, or around 500 meters in the size. So this asteroid basically, they spin comparatively less quickly, right? And it takes, you know, the revolution around 4.3 hours. So it takes, you know, around 4.3 hours to revolve once, right? So it has got enough time to collect this, you know, some samples from the asteroid Bennu by the spacecraft called, you know, your basically Orisys Rex mission. So it has also got this extra added benefit also. And scientists also claim that this asteroid Bennu will also have, you know, some sort of a the good composition of, you know, some sort of a minerals and other metals also. So the scientists will be able to analyze the asteroid's chemistry, mineralogy, right, in order to find out, you know, how the other asteroids have been found, how our solar system have been evolved over the period of the time. All right. Next, the National Human Rights Commission. As you know that National Human Rights Commission is basically a human rights watchdog in India. It was established in 1993. Right. So why this NHRC is in the news? Because the Justice Prafulla Chandra Pant, who was also the former Supreme Court judge, had been recently been appointed as an acting chairperson of NHRC, right, from April 25. Okay. So Mr. Justice Prafulla Chandra Pant have been appointed as an acting chairperson of NHRC. Now, regarding background of NHRC, so as I told you that NHRC was established in 1993, right? It was established in the conformity of the Paris principles. Okay. These Paris principles was adopted in the first international workshop that basically evolved over the period of the time with association with the national institutions, right, for the purpose of the protection of the human rights, which was held in the Paris in 1991. So this Paris principles were basically founding principles over which this NHRC have been established, right, in 1993. Recently, or not recently, in 1993, the parliament has passed an act called the Protection of the Human Rights Act 1993. Under this act, the National Human Rights Commission have been set up. So the Protection of the Human Rights Act basically provided the statutory recognition of, you know, this NHRC. NHRC have been headquartered in New Delhi. Okay, this is all you must understand. And the main purpose of NHRC is to serving the needs of the people of this country, to protect the rights related to their life, related to their liberty, equity, dignity of an individual, which is guaranteed by the constitution, and also which is embodied in the international covenants also. Okay, now let us understand what are these Paris principles. So first of all, the Paris principles constitute a set of internationally recognized standards, right, to assess the credibility, you know, independence and effectiveness of this national human rights institution throughout the world. Okay, now to be fully effective, the NHRIs or the national human rights institutions of throughout the world should have the broad mandate, right, to deal with all human rights. Like, for example, it should be inclusive, transparent sections, appointment process of their leadership, right, in terms of their independence, right, in terms of how to access sufficient resources, how to access the staff, right, how to cooperate effectively with the national and international, you know, stakeholders. All such issues have been greatly discussed and have been put under the Paris principles regarding the NHR, regarding NHRI, right, which is basically the national human rights institution throughout the world. So what happens is, exactly on December 20, 1993, what happens is a UN General Assembly adopted a resolution, right, on the national institutions for the promotion and the protection of human rights. This is a resolution which is titling as the National Institutions for the Promotion and the Protection of Human Rights, right? And this also annex and principles, which is known as basically the Paris principles, relating to the status of the national institutions. And these principles are basically known as, or this annex is known as basically the Paris principles. As I told you, what is Paris principles? So this Paris principles basically would encourage all the states around the world, all the states, all the countries around the world, to set up an independent national human rights institutions, right, for the purpose of the safeguarding of the rights, right, of the citizens of the country. And you must understand, NHRIs are basically the non-judicial independent institutions which are created by the countries, right, through their respective constitutions or the law. And the main mandate of NHRC is basically to promote and protect the human rights throughout the world. Now, we are concerning about the all the national human rights institutions. Obviously, when you come to the country, definitely for the purpose of promotion and protection of the human rights of our citizens of our country. Okay. Regarding the functioning of NHRC, as you know, the functioning of NHRC, that NHRC can take the suo motu. What is suo motu? Suo motu means by its own or self. That means it can by its own also, you know, can take or can investigate, right, any violation of the human rights, or it can also entertain a petition of from the person regarding some violation of the human rights or the failure of the state to protect or to prevent such human rights violations. Okay, the commission also conduct the research on how the human rights can be protected best in our country, right? It also involved in the creation of, you know, some sort of a, you know, the awareness campaigns through various mechanisms in our country. Okay, so such awareness campaigns are also conducted by the NHRC, right, through various mediums, through associations with, you know, with the NGOs in our country. Okay, regarding composition, the commission consists of a chairperson, the four full-time members, the four deemed members, right? And the regarding qualifications, right, this you know, the statute provide the qualifications as well as the appointment of the chairperson and the members of the commission. And the one qualification is that the chairperson of the NHRC should be the retired Chief Justice of India. So recently, you know, Mr. Prafulla Chandra Pant, the former Supreme Court judge, have been recently been appointed as a acting, you know, chairperson of National Human Rights Commission. Okay. Next, you have the Innovators Growth Platform. What is this Innovators Growth Platform? So you must understand that the SEBI, again, the commodity and the security regulator. So the regulator SEBI, right, in order to boost the startup ecosystem in our country, right, in order to boost this Innovators Growth Platform. So what is happening is that the SEBI is notifying is some sort of a relaxation in terms of norms, right? So that some sort of the holding period with respect to the pre-issued capital, right, would be given, right? And which also also allow some sort of a discretionary allotment to the eligible investors, right, for the purpose of boosting of the startup ecosystem in our country. So these changes have been made by the SEBI. So now you will be thinking that what is this startup is all about? The startups basically, are the companies or the ventures that are focused around a single product or the services, right? These founders basically want to bring to the market related to these single product on the services. And these companies typically don't have the fully developed business model, since they are just starting and they are just focusing on a single product and the services. So they are more crucially lack adequate capital to move, to the next phase of the business, right? So the government of India, through this SEBI, is basically boosting the startup ecosystem in our country through these relaxation measures, which have been adopted over the period of the time in terms of the pre-issue capital, in terms of the discretionary allotment, to that eligible investor. So what is happening is that these changes which have been made, right, definitely for the purpose of this Innovators Growth Platform, right, for the purpose of listing of those companies or these startups basically on the Innovators Growth Platform, right? And the Securities and Exchange Board of India, right, through a notification or on basically in April 5, 2019, right, amended basically a regulation which is known as the Issue of Capital and the Disclosure Requirement, Amendment Regulation 2019. So the SEBI, under this amendment to those regulation of 2019, launched this Innovators Growth Platform, okay, which is also, or which was also known as the Institutional Trading Platform. Why this Innovators Growth Platform was launched? For the purpose of listing of the issuers, right, which are in some sort of a intensive use of technology, right? Also, in the information technology or the intellectual property or the data analytics or some sort of a biotechnology or nanotechnology, right? So to provide some sort of a product, services and the business platform with substantial value addition, right? For that purpose, the Innovators Growth Platform have been launched. And this all comes after the board of SEBI basically have approved this proposal in the month of March for that purpose also. Okay, now the other relaxation which was also in, imposed, or which are also associated with those relaxations, are basically some sort of a easing of this delisting requirement, as well as relaxation in the guidelines for the purpose of the migrating to the main board, right? What is happening is that this delisting, or this delisting requirement, which have also been relaxed. So this delisting could be thought about profitable if some sort of a if the publish provide some sort of a acquirer or promoter shareholding, which is taken along with the shares which are tendered or accepted. If all this basically reaches to around 75% of the overall issued shares of that class, right, and no less than 50% of the shares of the general public shareholding are basically tendered and accepted. And further, for the purpose of delisting, the SEBI basically started, the SEBI basically stated a reverse book building mechanism, right, which is not going to be relevant. And for the purpose of computation of to provide the value, the fore value can be decided by the way of takeover of the loss, and together with the basically delisting premiums as justified by the acquirers and the promoters. So this all is aimed at making the platform, which is also known as, which is also known as your Innovators Growth Platform, to be more accessible to the companies in the view of evolving this startup ecosystem, right? And the regulator, right, have reduced the period of holding of 25% of the pre-issue capital, right, of the issuer's company by eligible investors to 1 year only from the current requirement of 2 years. Okay, and for that purpose, the term accredited investors for the purpose of this IGP have been renamed as Innovators Growth Platform Investors, right? And such investors pre-issue shareholding would be considered right for entire 25% of the pre-issue capital, right? And it will be for the issuer's company against the present limit of 10% only. Okay, next you have the business responsibility and the sustainability report, right? So here again, SEBI, which is also a security regulator, have come out with a disclosure requirement under, you know, some sort of a reporting related to the sustainability and the business responsibility. So this disclosure requirement have been brought by the SEBI, which is a regulator which covers the environmental perspective, the social perspective and the governance perspective with respect to those companies. Okay, now it will be applicable. It will be applicable to all top 1000 listed entities by the market capitalization as enforced by the SEBI, which is also a regulator. So this new report, which was brought by, you know, by the SEBI, titled as the Business Responsibility and the Sustainability Report, would replace basically the previous report called Business Responsibility Report. So right, this Business Responsibility and the Sustainability Report basically, you know, brought some sort of a, you know, the changes in terms of the disclosure requirement over the environmental, social and governance perspective of those listed companies by the market capitalization. Okay, so this move is expected to bring about the greater transparency, and it will definitely help those listed entities to participate, you know, in terms of those, you know, basically the sustainable goals, in terms of access of those sustainable related risks and the opportunities in our country. So under this basically, you know, some sort of you know, the basically your business responsibility and the sustainable report, where the listed company need to disclose about some sort of a, you know, the environmental, social and the governance related risk, right, as well as the opportunities from time to time, right? And this basically, this approach which was listed under this report called Business Responsibility and Sustainability Report would definitely try to mitigate and adapt the risk which is associated with this environmental perspective, social perspective, the governance perspective, along with some sort of a financial implications for the purpose of this. And this sustainability related goals and the targets and the performance, you know, need to be mentioned in the report by those listed entities, right, from the time to time. And you must understand, these environmental related disclosures are very, very important, because nowadays throughout the world, right, specifically in India, right, there is a huge pollution, right, huge, you know the ecosystem have been diluted over the period of the time, right, in terms of the air pollution, water pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, right, your the non-renewable form of energy, which is the main uses in India, right, to convert the non-renewable from basically from non-renewable to the renewable form of the energy, transitioning to the circular economy, right, you know, using the waste, right, again the waste generated circular economy in terms of that, water management practices, biodiversity management. So this environmental related disclosures is very, very important from the purpose of this. Okay, and social related disclosures, you can understand that if those companies or 1000 listed company, in terms of their working capital, if they put the social related disclosures, that would definitely beneficial for the work, for the workers, for basically consumers, like it will try to cover, you know, the conditions of the workforce, the value chain communities, as well as the consumers. And at the community level, you could think that, right, it will be beneficial for the community also. For example, these listed entity would now disclose some of the information related to the social impact assessment of those projects which they are concerning, which they are evolving, which they are trying to execute over the period of the time, right, related to those products, some sort of a rehabilitation and resettlement measures, right, how those peoples and, you know, those peoples would have, you know displaced, and how those resettlement and rehabilitation measures have been taken over the period of the time, the corporate social responsibility, how they are taking of those responsibilities with respect to development of those people. So all such community label, you know, disclosures would definitely help specifically to those people who are getting affected because of their projects. So this all about the business responsibility and sustainability report, right? The business responsibility and sustainability report, right? Definitely applicable on the top 100 listed entities by their markets capitalization, right? And definitely will boost some sort of a the system in our country as per the mandate given by the SEBI. Okay, next, the SEBI is said to be reporting that SEBI has brought that, you know, the companies which are the top 1000 listed companies, right, they should be providing this information for this year, for 2021-22, on the voluntary basis. But definitely the SEBI has also brought that from 2022-23, right, from that financial year, all 1000 listed company should be providing mandatorily these social, social perspective, environmental perspective, the governance perspective of their, you know, the projects. And this filing of this, you know, related to those, the environmental, social, and the governance disclosure, that ESG, basically the E means environment, the S means social, and G means governance. Okay, all those environmental, social, and governance perspective was to be introduced, right, by the SEBI in 2012 itself. And since then, a number of development have been taken place over the period of the time. Now SEBI has brought that from the financial year 2021-22, right, it will be optional, or it will be on the voluntary basis, from those 1000 listed company they should be disclosing those information, but compulsory from 2022-23 they should be mandatorily providing those information, right, from 2022-23, right, with that adoption of the Paris Agreement on the climate change. As you know that the average temperature throughout the world have been increasing, and the most important is the US UN sustainable goals, which are trying to be, you know, achieved by 2030, right? If we have, if the world need to achieve those sustainable development goals, we need to implement those principles also sincerely, and we try to adopt and mitigate those climate change related those impacts. And we should also try to aspire to transition to the sustainable economy rather than such type of economy which are bringing unsustainable development in the world, right? So these are some of the major issues globally that is also brought, you know, by the UN in the domain of the governance also. Okay, next you have basically the Sheikh Zayed Book Award. The Sheikh Zayed Book Award is basically granted, right, or it is basically, you know, provided as a literary award. It's been provided by the UAE or United Arab Emirates, right? So it is basically an award which have been provided to the people, to the institutions which have been contributed to the literary tradition. So this award is bestowed by the United Arab Emirates or UAE. Okay, it has been awarded to, you know, to the person, right, to the person or international figure or international organization, okay, for their contribution for the purpose of the advancement of Arabic culture, right, Arabic literature, right. And this prize basically consisting of around, you know, 1 lakh UAE dirhams, or which is approximately around, you know, you could think of around the, in terms of dollar, that is around 2.72 lakh dollars, right? So this award is basically, you know, granted by in the name that is being named after the Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan. The Sheikh Zayed, that is basically the name of the first president of UAE. So the name which is basically used in this award called Sheikh Zayed. The Sheikh Zayed is basically the first president of basically your UAE. So Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, which is the first president of UAE, right, to that name, the book award have been given to the prominent, you know, persons or the individuals who have contributed to for the advancement of the Arabic culture, right? So the this news basically is all about that prominent German philosopher, right, Jürgen Habermas, have recently turned down means he has declined to accept the Sheikh Zayed Book Award. He has said that the UAE has very bad, you know, the human rights record in terms of, you know, suppression of their own citizens, right, regarding some sort of a dissent. So the UAE is basically a country where some sort of a dissent have been brutally crushed by the state itself, right? And in that perspective, the German philosopher, the Jürgen Habermas, have recently been declined to accept this award. Okay, now if you want to understand more about that one, you must understand is that, right, you can think of this philosopher that is called Jürgen Habermas. The Jürgen Habermas is basically a prominent German philosopher, right, who is also a philosopher, intellectual, right. His career was full of accomplishments, right, various distinguished works, right, and which is also the most influential person specifically for the German cultural life for more than 50 years now, right. And you must also understand that Habermas has initially, you know, agreed to accept this Sieg Zayed Book Award, but later Mr. Jürgen Habermas have changed his mind, and it has also noted that he has corrected his mind of, you know, not accepting this Sieg Zayed Book Award because the prizes which was granted, you know, that is Sieg Zayed Book Award, have been granted by existing political system, which is very brutal in terms of, you know, criticizing, in terms of suppression of those criticizing people, right, which is very brutal in terms of the human rights records, right. And this is also all about, you know, the subject, or, you know, the reasons which was given by the Jürgen Habermas in terms of the declining of this award. Now this award is basically named after the Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, that is, I told you already, he was the first president of the UAE, right, when the Federation of the Seven Sikhdoms basically they came together, and ultimately the country was evolved in 1971. Okay, and while describing itself an independent initiative, this prize was basically administered by the Abu Dhabi Culture and the Tourism Authorities, and this prize basically consisting of an award which consisting of 1 million dirhams, that is around 3 lakh, that is around 3 lakh, you know, the precisely, if you want me to say that is around, you know, 2.72 lakh dollars, that is US dollars, or roughly you can say 272,000 the US dollars, right, that is around 1 million UAE dirhams. Dirhams is basically, you know, the currency of the Abu Dhabi, and you know, the other categories basically receives around 2 lakh US dollars, right, that is basically, you know, the prize which is associated with this literary prize. All right, so here you could see basically the political map of the United Arab Emirates. So what you could see is that the United Arab Emirates sometimes is also known as simply Emirates. Okay, now as you see this political map, you could see that it is a country in the Western Asia, which is located at the eastern end of Arabian Peninsula. So this is basically in eastern end of Arabian Peninsula. So it is located in the eastern end of Arabian Peninsula, and it is clearly visible here that it is bordered with the Oman and Saudi Arabia. So you have Saudi Arabia and the Oman, right? And it has the maritime borders also. Here you could see the Persian Gulf. So that means it has the maritime border also, right, with the Persian Gulf, where the Qatar and the Iran is also on the other side. You could see here the Iran, and there is also one other country called Qatar is also, you know, located nearby. All right, so this is all about the political map. You could see, you know, in your the Orient Black Swan map for the purpose of better understanding of this political map of UAE. All right, so that's all for today. So thank you very much for attending this session. Please take care of yourself. We'll definitely meet tomorrow. Thank you very much.